Yeah, both my boss and my underboss. One did 165 years, the other did 139 years. Now they're both dead. I outlived them both. Michael Franzese. Hope everybody is doing well. And another day, here we go. And the last time, if you remember, when we did the video on the 50 biggest and wealthiest mob bosses from the Fortune magazine article written in 1986, we actually went down the list. We went down through all 50 and kind of gave their status where they are now. And just a very, very little bit about them personally. And I told you I would pick certain ones out on that list, and we would do a little bit about it because people are always asking me. You know, I always usually get the same, you know, people asking me about the same people. Everybody wants to know about Roy DeMeo. I understand why. There's certain guys that they ask about a lot. I do get asked about one of these two fairly often, so we're going to talk about them. We're going to talk about them together because, you know, there's some guys that, you know, have a lot to talk about. You know, they got a major history. For instance, if you're talking about Gotti, you can go on for hours and hours and hours. They make documentaries about the guy. But some guys, there's not that much to talk to because even though they were, and I'm not demeaning them, don't get me wrong, but they weren't one of those figures that, you know what I'm talking about, that had that much media, that much notoriety, that much publicity, like we spoke about my former boss, Carmine Persico. And he had, in that life, a pretty, you know, illustrious career, I would say, if that's the right word, I don't know. But, you know, some of the others don't have that same kind of background or that same kind of information about them. So we're going to talk about two. But before I get into that, if you remember, out of the 50, I had said, if you keep in score, that 46 of them were dead, and they're definitely dead, and that four were still alive. Two are in prison, one 91 years old, the other 83 years old, will probably die in prison because they tried to get compassionate releases and they were denied just recently. And then one, Anthony Indelicato, Anthony Bruno, he was alive, he is alive, 74 years old, and he's free. Well, I made a mistake. He's not free. He's in prison. His release date is May of 2023. So what does that tell you? It tells you that out of the 50, 46 are dead, three are still alive, but three of them are in prison, and the only one that's alive and free is yours truly. Now, I want to make this clear. That doesn't make me better than anybody else, doesn't make me smarter than anybody else. A lot of those guys were older than me to begin with, but it certainly makes me more blessed than anyone else because people I survived, you know, 18 arrests, seven indictments, two federal racketeering indictments, five major trials, 8 years in prison, and then a lot of stuff afterwards, you know, with people upset with me for walking away from that life. So, you know, and I just consider myself to be very fortunate, very blessed. Could it certainly have turned out, you know, a lot worse for me. So, you know, I'm one of the fortunate ones. So having said that, the two that I'm going to speak about today are number five, Gerry Langella, Gerry Lang. He was on a list listed as number five. Total mistake because Persico, his boss, my boss, was number six. Well, that's not true, okay? It should have been the reverse. If any of that list was true, it should have been the reverse. But a lot of things weren't. I told you that I didn't agree with. A lot of names on there that shouldn't have been on there, and a lot of names that should have been on there that weren't on there. My father wasn't even on the list, so, and I always considered him a powerhouse. But anyway, so let's talk about Gerry Lang, and then number 11 on the list, Ralph Scopo. Two Colombo guys, two guys I knew very, very well. I'll get into it just a little bit, one at a time. Gerry Lang, who was my underboss, the underboss of the Colombo family. He was very, very close to Junior. They grew up together. Junior trusted him a lot. Gerry was, let me put it this way, he wasn't an easy guy to warm up to and get close to. I had to see him a lot, especially when I was a recruit and had to report to Carroll Street. That was kind of where he hung out before he hung out at Casa Stork. He was there all the time. And I had to check in with him, you know, quite often. He was a pretty kind of stoic guy, always dressed real sharp, always liked to have a drink in his hand. He enjoyed it. A lot of fun when we went out, you know, if we ever went out together to socialize. But he was kind of a pretty stringent, you know, no-nonsense kind of guy. Junior trusted him. He was, like I said, an underboss. He was the acting boss when Junior went away, when he was on the lam. And, you know, I reported to him about certain things, you know, that were going on with gas and so on and so forth. So, you know, but a good guy, you know, good guy. Always got in trouble, you know. He did a lot of time. He ended up dying in prison, you know, a couple of years back. I listed that the other day. And so... But the reason I'm speaking about him with number 11, Ralph Scopo, because they had a lot in common. I'll get into that. Ralph Scopo, number 11 on the list. I knew Ralph, you know, just about my whole life. He was with my dad, you know, for a long time. And then, you know, my dad went away and, you know, Ralph, he continued in the family. He got made. He was a soldier. He wasn't a capo during my time, capo regime. But what was important about Ralph Scopo is that he was the president of one of the concrete district council unions, and it was a very powerful position. Gerry Langella also had something to do with that. Gerry Lang, because I'm going to talk about the concrete club. What was the concrete club? Well, it was the basis of two major indictments. One, the Colombo indictment, and the number two, the commission trial. So let's get into the Colombo trial, I should say. And what was it based upon? It was based upon the fact that Ralph Scopo initially was extorting concrete contractors, getting money from them so that they can become part of this concrete club, maybe. What was the concrete club? The concrete club was a number of cement contractors that was selected by all five families, by the commission. And if you were in that club, you were the contractors that were going to get the major jobs. Jobs, I think, between $2 million and $15 million. If it was below $2 million, they didn't care. But anything from $2 million to $15 million, you were in this certain club that was selected by the commission. You would get the job. And as a result, you had to pay a 2% commission back to all five families, and they would whack it up. Now, I was very familiar with that because it happened during my time. It was all in the 80s that I was aware of this. And so Gerry Lang and Ralph Scopo were principal parties in this. As a result of Ralph Scopo being caught on tape many, many times, shaking down some of the contractors. Look, you can only do that for so long. Contractors or anybody that you're shaking down, you know, if you don't dispose of them at a certain point in time, if they're not happy, they're going to run to the law. It happens all the time. Well, they ran to the law. There were a lot of tapes where Ralph was extorting people, and that was the basis of this trial. Gerry Lang was involved in it. Persico was involved in it. A whole bunch of Colombo guys, and they all got convicted, and they all got pretty heavy time. I think Persico Jr. got 39 years on that, if I'm not mistaken. Gerry Lang got 65 years, and Ralph Scopo got a bunch of years also. So they were, and that was in the early 80s. So they're already in a lot of trouble. And during that same time, Giuliani in the Southern District is doing what? He's working on the commission case. Giuliani, you know, and I know his name causes a lot of controversy, but Giuliani, he was the number three guy in D.C. under the Reagan administration. He left that post to come to the Southern District of New York because that's a very high-profile position, and he wanted to do cases. And he was smart. He knew that, you know, if you're a high-profile prosecutor in New York and you make your name for yourself, you know, that leads to bigger and better things. And obviously did. He became the mayor at some point in time. But he had a thing. And I think, according to him, it started from his childhood. His father was a legitimate guy. They're Italian, obviously. And his father hated mob guys, hated the mafia, hated mob guys. And the reason for that is because he said that they gave, you know, hardworking, legitimate mob guy, legitimate Italians, a bad name. You know, I've heard that from people. There's some legitimate Italians out there that very upset with mob guys because everybody with a vowel in their name, you know, you think they're part of the mob. And a lot of people resented that. And allegedly, Giuliani's father was one of them. So he came in with this preconceived notion that all mob guys are no good. He said when he was an attorney, he would never represent a mob guy because he said if he got him off, they'd go back to being criminals again, and he didn't want any part of it. So he comes down from Washington, and he immediately starts to target the mob. He's the guy that said, you know what? we don't want to go after the low-level guys. Let's go after the whole commission. I mean, you know, all the top leaders in the mob, the commission, and we can do that under the RICO Act. So as a result, the FBI, a number of different agencies, they start to work together. And they start to plant bugs, and they use, informants, and they get all sorts of surveillance techniques, because quite honestly, we didn't keep up with that stuff. The surveillance techniques became very sophisticated. And Ralph Scopo, again, you know, extorting people, they used a lot of these tapes to indict the guys on the commission. So like it or not, you know, You got to give Giuliani either the credit or the blame for everything that went down with that commission case. Ralphie Scopo, getting back to them, he was a principal. He was not in good graces as a result of, the tapes that came forward on him. What saved him is that there were such incriminating surveillance tapes on Tony Ducks that he said, hey, you know, what are we going to do? This is part of the life. We all got caught up on it, but I know he wasn't in good graces as a result of that. And Gerry, the same thing. So Gerry now has 165 years running wild, meaning back to back. He dies in prison. Ralph Scopo died in prison, I think, in 1993. The sad thing about that, his son Joseph, who I knew, he was murdered, a few months later. So father and son died in the same year as a result of their involvement in that life. So that's really it. You know, like I said, with these two guys, a shame, two guys that I knew well. And look, I always feel bad when I look back and I see, you know, how this ended up for all of these people. It's sad, people. And that's why I say it all the time. The mob life, the gang life, evil lifestyles. I'm not calling the guys evil. I was one of them. I just happen to be very fortunate, very blessed. But the lifestyle is evil because people get hurt, families get destroyed, and the guys that are involved normally end up dead or in prison for the rest of their lives. So any lifestyle that is that way, how good could it be? So that's it for today. Again, you know, I think we're approaching 360,000 subscribers. We're getting up there. Remember, when we hit 500,000, huge giveaway. You're going to love it. I promise we got it planned already. Not only one, but a bunch of prizes are going to go out. So keep subscribing. You get alerts. You're going to get good content. We keep working hard on that. MichaelFranzese.com, my inner circle. We're having Zoom calls. We're putting a lot of content in there. People are loving it. I'd love to post some of the comments that I get for all of you to see. It's really going well. And in our free crew, same thing. You know, we got over 11,000 people in there now, and it's growing every day. So, and we really appreciate the support that you're giving us all. We work hard to make it all good for all of you so that you benefit by it. So that's it for today. And my friends, how do I always leave you? The same way, from my heart. Be safe, be healthy. God bless every one of you, and I'll see you next time.